So today we have Dr. Roberto Soto coming from us from California State University. I hope you guys enjoy. He'll be speaking on a journey through the world of numbers. My journey has been fabulous. His, I'm sure, has been sprinkled with great times as well. So will yours. Enjoy.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Appreciate it. And thank you for having me here today. Can you all hear? It's been a while since I've spoken to this many people. Okay, good, good. Well, thank you to the math department. Thank you to Dr. Harris for bringing me here. I've enjoyed my time so far. I got in last night from California. The weather is nice here right now. It's not too bad, right? So you guys can go out without jackets now, so it's kind of nice. I want to talk about my journey through the world of numbers. It's kind of gone, it's been a roller coaster for me. I didn't know that I wanted to be a mathematician. It wasn't something that, as a little kid, I said, hey, yes, I want to be a mathematician. In fact, I didn't even know what that meant. My mom had only gotten to the sixth grade when she was in Guatemala. My dad had only gotten to eighth grade. And so when they discovered that I was really good at math, they go, well, why don't you become an engineer? Because everybody they knew back in their towns, that's what they became when they were good at math. So that's what I thought I was going to be. It just took me a really long time to realize that it wasn't the engineering that excited me. And I should have known since I was like maybe, since I learned how to count. So I was a little strange as a boy. One of the first things I used to do when we used to travel to San Diego was in California, was I would count cars. As we drove by, I would count cars. I don't know why, I just did. Well, I do know why now. My parents told me, they would ask me why I would count cars, and I would tell them, you know what I want to do? I want to get to the last number in the universe. That was my goal, was to get to the last number. I didn't know infinity existed. I was maybe 6 or 7 years old. Then I got to third or fourth grade, when you learn how to carry when you add. And so I realized, you know, there's a faster way of getting to the largest numbers. So I decided to add 1 plus 1 to get 2, and then 2 plus 2 to get 4, and then 4 plus 4 is 8, because I learned how to double. I thought of exponential growth. I thought this would be great. I didn't call it that. I just thought I'd just get to the biggest number much, much faster. And of course, my parents being, you know, I was being quiet. I was sitting down, writing numbers down. So they just let me do this for hours, hours on end. I got to pretty large numbers, and finally, I think my mom felt bad for me. And she goes, what are you doing? I go, I'm trying to get to the last number of the universe. She goes, you know, there is no such thing. And I go, no, it has to be. It has to be the largest number. And this is the first proof I ever encountered. I love proofs now, but I didn't realize my mom, only sixth grade, but she gave me my first proof. She goes, think of the largest number that you know. And at that time, I had heard the word Google, and it doesn't mean what you guys know as Google, and it's not even spelled the same, because when I was growing up, there was no internet. Not at least in our homes. And Google there is spelled with an O L at the end instead of L-E. So same first four letters, then O-L. And it means a one with 100 zeros, I think, after it, or something like that. Or a million zeros. I forget what it was, actually. But I go, Google. And she goes, well, I can think of a number bigger than that. And I go, well, what is that? I don't believe you can think of a number bigger than Google. And she goes, a Google plus one. And it kind of blew my mind away. I was like, whoa, that's the coolest thing I've ever heard. That's when I should have known that I really liked math. That's when it should have become clear that that's what I wanted to do. But when I got to high school, it turns out that math wasn't fun anymore. Oh, one more story, because I do weird things. I used to walk home from school and think about numbers. And that's why it's a world of numbers. And I still think about things that are very similar to numbers. I used to think about the associative property, the commutative property. And I used to go home. My teacher just told me that it doesn't matter which way I add numbers. It's going to be true. And I go, that's not true. That can't be true. That's impossible. And so I go, because I just learned about negatives. How is it that negative 5 plus 2, it doesn't matter if I add them either way? And so these are the things that sort of went through my mind. And then something happened in high school where math became too much of a thing to memorize. And that's when I said, I don't like math anymore. I think geometry was the last high school math class that I finally enjoyed. And it wasn't until I got to college that I learned about calculus that finally, and I was in a calculus class today, the stuff that you guys were doing. That's when finally I go, oh, this is kind of interesting. And yet still I didn't care so much about the applications. I cared more about how to prove stuff. That was what was interesting to me. And then finally, the first time that I go, ooh, this is something I might want to do was when I encountered this object. This is an object that you guys are actually very familiar with, except you don't write it this way. And I really should have used 24, because I think, you'll see in a minute why I use 24. But one of the first things I discovered in my undergraduate algebra class was that there are other objects that are based on numbers, but that aren't really numbers, yet have very similar properties to numbers. And this is one of these objects. So what we do is we take all the integers, every single whole number that you've ever seen before, positive and negative, you divide it by 12, and then you record the remainder. And then you make sets of this. You partition the integers into these sets. So for example, if I write here, I say this bracket, hopefully I can write this. Oh, that's a real marker. Maybe not that one. So right here, if I do this one more, how does this work? Anybody know? Dr. Harris? Is there a way for me to use the board or no?
I think you can just hit it on that side.
So usually this one works. No, no.
Okay. Well, it's okay. I don't need to write. I think because I'm on my computer.
Might be your computer.
Okay, my computer doesn't know. But anyways, I take this bracket and I say, you know, think of all the numbers whose remainder is 1 when you divide by 12. So for example, the 1. When you divide by 12, when you divide 1 by 12, the remainder is 1. Or 13. When you divide 13 by 12, the remainder is 1. Or 25. When you divide by 12, the remainder is 1. So collect all those numbers and put them in a set. Put them in this bracket called 1. Take all the numbers whose remainder is 5. Take all the numbers whose remainder is 4 when you divide by 12. So you construct these 12 different sets because there's 12 different remainders. Either 0 remainder, 1, 2, 3, all the way to 11. So you have all these. And then you go, okay, so I did that. What next? Well, then you start asking certain questions. Is it possible to add numbers like this, these sets, these collections of numbers? Can you actually add them with each other? So what that means, what that translates into regular English is the following. Think of a number, for example, that's divisible, that whose remainder is 1. Just think of a number, any number, when you divide by 12, the remainder is 1. Think of a different number that when you divide by 12, its remainder is 5. Okay. Think of those two numbers, add them together. Will you get something, a number, who, when you divide by 12, the remainder is 6? And hopefully you're convinced that, yes, this is always true. Right? You pick 13, that's a number who, when you have a remainder, when you divide by 12, it's 1. Okay, that's 13. Then I pick 5, because when you divide 5 by 12, you get a remainder of 5. And 13 plus 5 is 18. And then 18, when you divide by 12, the remainder is 6. And you can play this game all day with any numbers of the sets. And so what we've done is we've created something new, some new object, when we just talk about remainders. And those of you who have done computer science, you know this as modulus. Right? So you know this as modulus. And so this is sort of what we're doing. And then we asked other questions. So if we add it, is it well defined? Do you have something like a 0? You know, is there a set that sort of acts like 0? Think of all the numbers that so the 0 in this case is the numbers whose remainder is 0, right? For example, if you add 5 and you add it to 12, you're going to get 17, but the remainder is still going to be 5, regardless. Or if you add 5 and add it to 24, that would give you 29, but the remainder is still 5. So any number whose remainder is 0 sort of acts like a 0. So the set acts like a 0. And so there's sort of a 0. And then is there an inverse and its associative? So we ask all the questions, but these aren't really numbers. These are blocks of numbers. These are complete sets of numbers. And so we ask this, you know, just types of questions. We start creating objects like this. And this is what I like to do. I find this very, very interesting. Most people don't find it interesting for the same reason I do. Most people actually use this every single day, and I'm hoping you thought about this. You actually, maybe you've had a class already that's explained this to you. Do you guys know when you use this? You use it, well, maybe not anymore, but before you came here, you used to use this all the time. In fact, you used to do that, you used to do something like this. This is weird math. You would say 5 plus 8 is 1. You would always do that every single day of your lives.
Time.
Time. If it's 5 in the morning, 8 hours later, right? Is that 1? Yeah, it is 1, right? I can do math. All right, so this is where we find it, in the clock, time. Time works this way. Okay, time is sort of a remainder, except that for us, it's kind of weird to have a 0 up here at the end, but this is sort of what I'm thinking in my head, that we have the 0 at the end. So some people call modulus math clock math, because you can think of other societies, or maybe Martians, who maybe they only have 4 hours. And so instead of a clock like this, they have a clock of 4 hours. And so they think about remainder 4. What happens when you divide by 4, and what's the remainder then? Okay, so these are the objects that I find interesting. And so then we start looking as mathematicians other places where this is applied. You know, that was kind of, okay, so time works, that's really nice. And so then you start thinking about something like this. This is a square, and what some people want to study is how you rotate the square. And let's do counterclockwise so the math works later on. And so there's 4 objects in the set. Again, these are not numbers. I'm just describing a rotation. I'm saying that, you know, R90 means do you rotate, let me see, clock for me is this way, so this is counterclockwise for you guys. So rotate 90 degrees, that's one object, or you can take the square and rotate it 180 degrees, or you can do 270, or you can do 360, okay? And then you ask yourself certain questions. Is there one of these elements, one of these four elements that sort of acts like zero? So can you rotate once and then rotate by another one of these rotations and end up in the same spot? So look, I do have a prop for this. So in case you're more of a visual person, I forgot to take it out. I have your newspaper. This is almost a square, right? And so this would be 90 degrees. If I rotate it by what amount will I end up back here again? 360. Or I can rotate it 270 degrees. But again, if you rotate by 360, don't I end up right here? So rotation by 360 is sort of like a zero, because it doesn't do anything. And that's what zero does for us. It doesn't do much, right? You add 5 plus 0, you get 5. And so rotation by 360 is sort of a zero. And so we start wondering, wow, this is very similar to something we've already seen before. Again, it only has four elements. And in fact, it's very similar. Before I go to the similarity, I forgot to mention this. So what we do is we construct multiplication tables. So we say, you know, well, if I rotate by 90 and then I rotate it by another 90, I get rotation of 180. And that's what this is saying right here. If you rotate it by 90 and then rotate it by 90, you get 180. And so this keeps track of all the answers. And notice that we always, which one's the light? The red one? Okay. Notice that all the answers, regardless of how you rotate, you're going to get only these four, 360, 270, 90, or 180. You'll never get anything other than that. You'll only get those four answers. In fact, you can even do 270 once, so that's 270 degrees, and then you can do 270 again, and that's really a rotation of how much from the original? 180, and that's what it says, right? 270 and 270, if you look really closely, there's 270 and there's 270, where's 270, there it is. It's equal to a rotation of 180 degrees. So instead of going 270 twice, we could have just done 180. Well, it turns out that this is very similar to a different object. And like I said, if we ever encounter aliens, you know, you can have a clock with four. What if you live in a planet that only has 4 hours, and you only kept track of those 4 hours, then you'd have something like this. And so we started looking at this table. This is an addition table. Here, if I add 3 plus 3, what that means is I get 6, but if you divide by 4, the remainder is 2. Okay, so 3 plus 3 is 4. It's 6, but then when you divide by 4, you get a remainder of 2. And so that's why the table says 2 right there. Well, this table and this table, look for any similarities. Okay. The numbers are completely different. But see if you can find any patterns here, and I'm going to switch to the other one and this one. The diagonals, right? And there it is. I color-coded it so you guys can see this. And so in my language, because it is a language, I say these two different objects are isomorphic. They're, to me, they're the same. To you, you see different symbols. To me, they're exactly the same. They're like twins to me. Okay, they're exactly the same object. And so the reason I care as an algebraist, as a mathematician, is if I do a proof and I can prove something here, I understand this very well, which I understand very well, and I'm trying to understand this new object, then whatever I've proven on the right, the same thing holds on the left. And so it's a way for us to go from different worlds. And so this is sort of the game that mathematicians play. You know, can I understand one object really well? Can I find some mapping that makes the other object understandable? And then now I can go in both directions. And so your first encounter with that in your classes was inverses. The first time you guys have done inverse functions. That's what the first thing you were doing, was going from one world to the other one, because they're exactly similar. And so what we call this, what I like to do is, these objects are still too abstract for me. And to me, they're just still too many symbols going around. And in fact, how many of you have taken linear algebra? Okay, good. All right, so you guys will understand the next part. So what happens is that we have the only thing we truly, truly understand, I think, as mathematicians, like we really have a good handle on, is linear algebra. We understand matrices very well. We know how to find eigenvalues very well. We know how to do rational canonical form. We know how to do Jordan canonical form. Or at least we know that computers can do it for us very, very well. Okay, we can do these things. We could program computers. And so one of the things that we do, or that I do, is I look at these abstract objects and I go, can I make them look like something I understand? And what I understand are matrices. And so that's what this slide is saying here, is that any of these objects that you just seen, I can describe with an array of numbers. A matrix is just an array of numbers. And this array of numbers will give me lots of information about what I know. And this is finally, this is a, sort of what I started doing as my PhD. So going through the journey again, just to make sure you kind of understand, it was during my sophomore year that I started seeing stuff like this, when I go, oh, this is kind of interesting to me. You know, this is the stuff that I like to do. But I was a little bit too afraid, because I thought that all of math had been proven already. You know, you go to your classes and all the answers are already known, right? There's always an answer. And so I thought everything was proven, and when people asked me what I wanted to do, I'd be like, well, I don't know, teach. What else do you do with a math degree? You just teach. And I couldn't do engineering. As much as my parents tried, I'm not very good at designing things. I'm not very good at working with my hand. In fact, the only thing I was pretty good at was computers, and I did try that out for a year, but I kept coming back to math. Math kept calling me, and it was these things that kept calling me, just these ideas that just make me feel like, I don't know why this is to be able to study something that's so abstract, just really kind of, especially because it's like numbers. That's what I really enjoy, is the fact that this was very similar to numbers, but they weren't numbers. But anyways, going back, this is what I call a representation. What I'm saying here is that the 0 goes to this matrix 1, 0, 0. The 1 goes to this matrix. The 2 goes to this matrix. And if you've never seen matrices, although I think you're supposed to see them in high school now, correct? Most of you seen matrices in high school? Mm-hmm. And so you've learned how to multiply them probably at one point. And because I said z mod 4z, this object here is very similar to the rotations of the square, that means I can do the same thing with the rotations. Okay? I can do exactly the same thing with the rotations, and I go to the same matrices. What I'm really saying, though, and this is where it starts becoming more applicable to those of you that are more into engineering or applied math, this one right here, R90, it's a specific matrix. If I rotate 90 degrees twice, I get 180. So if this works out the way I think it works out, or the way it's supposed to work out, if I multiply this matrix times itself, I should get this matrix. Oh, yeah. Okay. That's what that's saying right there. That's what that means. So let me show you a little program. So this is a free program online. It's called GeoGebra. Although you guys use Mathematica, unfortunately my version doesn't work right now. But here is... so here, you guys can see that, hopefully. Force. All right, let's see if this works. So there's my matrix R. And I'm saying that if you multiply R times R, I should get... So R for me is the rotation by 90 degrees. Is that too small for you guys? It's probably not. I don't even know if you can see. Okay. For those of you in the front, they can confirm in the back what's going on. But the people in the front can tell, yeah, he told you what he told you was true. The first matrix is supposed to be the R, the rotation by 90. And when you multiply by itself, it gives you the second one. And again, you can do this online. There's lots of applications that are multiplied matrices for you. This is not something that's completely new. But that's what it is that I'm trying to say here, is that these matrices now describe what's going on. And the reason I like matrices, or the reason you may want to know matrices, is matrices can describe motion. So what these matrices do, what this specific matrix does, it actually takes this vector here, so those of you who've taken physics, this vector right here, and it really does rotate it 90 degrees clockwise. And so as a programmer, if you're into computer science, now you know how to do rotations by 90 degrees. And if you want to do rotations by other degrees, now you know that there are matrices that will do this for you. And this is the stuff where this sort of was born, this idea of rotations. And so this is sort of very applicable. And so I have this slide, why do we care? And I put we in quotation marks, because this is not why I care, but this is why as a society we sort of care. Well, there's obviously applications to physics. All these matrices move. And in fact, what we really care about are maybe three-dimensional motion, right? And how do you model that? And so these you can create matrices that will model three-dimensional motion for you. Okay. Chemistry, this is a sort of a huge one. It turns out that certain molecules, they're understood by the symmetry in the molecules. Okay? And one of the things that plays, whenever you say symmetry, you're talking about the objects that I'm talking about. Our objects, I call them groups. But in chemistry, they're working with symmetry. And it turns out if you understand the symmetry of an object, of a molecule, you actually understand a lot of its properties that you wouldn't have had before. Computer science, it turns out, and Dr. Harris and I saw this a couple years ago, where if you're coding, you want to develop faster code. It turns out that understanding these representations allows you to make some algorithms much faster than ever before. Biology, we also saw this a couple summers ago. There's these molecules, and those of you who've taken science should know this, that when you try to study a molecule under a microscope, as soon as you try to look at it, you put light on it. And as soon as you hit a molecule with light, you completely change the molecule, because you've added energy to the system, and so now the molecules start moving around. And so how do you model a molecule you can't see if you can't really look at it? And so one of the techniques that they're using is actually freezing these molecules and then kind of trying to take a picture right away. But when you freeze these molecules, you don't know how you froze the molecules. It could have moved. It could have been like this, or it could have been rotated. And so you use these rotations, this idea of rotations, to study the molecules. You assume that they're going to rotate a certain way. You use some probability. And then you're able to model what the molecule looks like. And of course, data analysis. Right now that we're in an election year, or that we're doing all the primaries, data analysis, turns out there's a lot of symmetry in the elections, and there's ways to analyze elections through the stuff that I'm doing. That's not why I care. I just care because it's fun. That's really what I do. So a mathematician just does math because it's fun. That's what I do. I mean, I told you about all these things. I don't think I can do any of these things. I've heard people talk about these things, and I think it's really cool, but that's not why I do it. I just do it because I think it's a lot of fun. And that's the one thing I taught high school. So after going back to the journey, after I got my degree, my bachelor's in math, I didn't know what to do with it. So I said, I'll become a high school teacher. And I taught high school math for 8 years in California. And I used to tell my kids all the stories you've heard so far, they've heard many, many times. Because I thought that was really cool. I was just really cool that you can study things that are like numbers, but they're not really numbers. And I thought that was amazing. And they kept asking me, what does a mathematician do? What does a mathematician do? And I kept saying, I don't know. They prove stuff, but I don't know what they prove. You know, what kind of stuff do they prove? I don't know. And so eventually my students, but I kept telling my students what I tell, like I'm sure your professors tell you here, is, you know, you got to pursue that stuff that you love, and you really got to work hard at it, and you really got to try your best, and never put a ceiling on yourself, just kind of keep going. And I couldn't do that for myself. And then finally I go, you know what, I should practice what I preach. If I'm telling my kids they should continue to go to school, I should kind of figure out what mathematicians do. And I really like math, because I still kept thinking about these things. And so what I try to do is I look at objects that are even more abstract than what I've described so far. And so now, all we do as mathematicians, I feel sometimes, is we make things that were kind of easy and just add layers of abstraction. But there's a really good reason for this, and this is one of them. So I'm saying that the rotations of the square, I can describe them in this way. This is a different way of describing these rotations. I'm saying that there are elements that are generated by multiplying R. So that's how you read this notation. So I'm going to take R, and I'm just going to multiply by itself as many times as I want. But there's one property. If I multiply R times itself four times, I'm going to get one. Well, the way that's interpreted physically is, if I rotate, the R really stands for the rotation by 90 degrees. Right? And if I rotate four times, where am I going to be at? I lost my prop. If I rotate four times, where am I going to end up? Back where I started, right? So here is my R. Here's my rotation by 90 degrees. But if I do this four times, one, two, three, four, I end up back where I started. And so that's what I mean by R to the fourth is equal to one. I'm just saying that when I rotate four times, it's equal to one. I don't see it that way. I only explain it that way so people that don't do what I do understand what's going on. But that's really all I'm saying. When I rotate it four times, you get back to where you started with. And then there's really four elements. You can rotate by 90 degrees, that's the first R. You can rotate twice, which is 180 degrees. You can rotate three times, or you can just not rotate at all. And so that's how I describe that. I like this notation because now it marries both of the worlds that I've been describing. You know, you can rotate. But notice that if you multiply any of these two, for example, R squared and R cubed, you guys know how to multiply R squared and R cubed. What do you do with the powers? Right, you add them, so R to the fifth. But R to the fifth, that really means rotating five times, right? Rotating five times. And I end up here, which is really rotation by how many degrees? 90 degrees. So you see, it's really the same thing. It's just a different way. So I just did adding mod 4. We got 5, but when you divide by 4, the remainder is 1. And so that's how, to me, this notation kind of marries the two worlds that I started talking about. You know, rotation by 90 degrees or Z mod 4Z. So the groups that I look at are a little bit more complicated. We add a layer of complication. We still look with the square. And we say you can rotate 90 degrees, sure. But you can also rotate, you can also do a reflection. That's a symmetry. And so the S stands for a reflection across the horizontal axis. Now I could have chosen any axis. I could have done this one. Or I could have done this one. But I just choose one axis of rotation, and that's the one I'm going to use. So this, I decided to make it easy for myself and rotate this way. It's easier to program the computer to do a reflection this way. For me, at least, it was easier. And so there's eight elements in this group. That's why it's the dihedral group of eight. Now, a lot of people do notation differently. I like to use eight. Some people use four. I like the eight because it tells me how many elements are in this group. There's eight of them there. And these are the elements on there. And so the top ones you already know. Rotation by 90, rotation by 180, rotation by 270. But these here at the bottom, if I do SR, here's what I'm saying to do. We read backwards, by the way. You do R first. So R, you rotate by 90. And then S means you go this way. Okay. So R squared is rotate by 180. And then the S, you do this way. And the reason we go backwards is because you guys have composed functions before. You know how you do the inside function first and then you work your way out? That's what this is saying. We're composing here. This is a composition. It's telling you do R and then do R and then do S. And so that's why we read it in this way. And then, of course, there's a representation, which is what I like to do. These representations here, these matrices. And again, since you can't see GeoGebra or my little app, this is what it's supposed to do. I had a picture just in case. I had a feeling it wasn't going to work the way I wanted to. But R does a rotation by 90 degrees, and S really does this reflection across the x-axis. It really does the horizontal. And so now those of you that like programming, now you know how you can how you can program rotations and horizontal reflections. This is how I would program it anyway, to get actions. And so now you can make a movie. Now you know, you can rotate by 90 degrees and you can flip stuff. And you can keep doing this. You can do rotation by anything. So what do we do? What do I do? Well, I ask myself these types of questions. I've given you one representation. I've given you one set of matrices that works. Is this the only one? That's the questions that we ask. Is this the only representation that's ever possible? So mathematicians always ask themselves this. Is this unique? Is this the only one that's possible? If we can find other ones, do they have anything in common? Are there other ways to represent this? Anything in common? Can I get one from the other one? How many representations can I find? This is a big question for a long time. Given a specific group, how many representations can you find? And then if you find them, can you classify them? And I think we've finished, if I'm correct, we've finished classifying them. So we know all the representations, at least all the groups, except for the ones that I work with. They're kind of hard to classify, actually, the ones that I work with. I'll explain those in a minute. I have about a few minutes left. So these are all the building blocks. So our field, when we work over the real numbers or the complex numbers, it works really nice. It turns out that I can create any representation of the dihedral group by just putting these together. And I can make them really long. So I can make matrices that are really big. But along the diagonal, these are the numbers of the matrices that you'll find. And these are all representations. So I can definitely build tons of them. But there's only five building blocks. These are like our atoms. And any other representation comes from these five, or something that's similar to this five. I would say isomorphic. Similar is not strong. Me, in particular, what I like to do is I like to ask questions about, do I really have to work with the complex numbers? Do I really have to work with the real numbers? Can I work with something that's a little bit more abstract? The field that I like is a very nice field because it only has two numbers. It only has 0 and 1. I work with Z mod 2Z. That's it. Only 0 and 1. Here's how it works in my field. 0 plus 0 is 0, where I work. That's nice. 1 plus 0 is 1 still, and 0 plus 1. Either way, it's still 1. But 1 plus 1 is 0. Because when I do mod 2, it means that I divide by 2 and I look at the remainders. Well, what's the only remainders when you divide by 2? 1 and 0. So I only work with 1s and 0s. So I hope that one day, whatever I do, computer scientists will like. I haven't found a computer scientist yet that can use my work. But that's what I keep hoping for, because I only work with 0s and 1s, nothing else. But I add extra numbers. So we do this all the time in math. You guys, that whiteboard works, right? Okay, can I have someone write for me? Or maybe this one over here. This is a real marker. Can you write x squared plus 1 on that board? Any of you, please? Since I can't get to it. Really big so everybody can see.
X squared plus
Yeah, x squared plus 1. Really big, so everybody can see. There you go. There you go.
On both sides.
Oh, you did it on both sides. Nice. Okay, good. All right. So that equation, if I want to know when that equation is zero, or when that expression is zero, not an equation, but when I want to know that expression is zero, is there a number that you know that's a real number that when you plug into that expression will give you zero? No. So what do we do as mathematicians? We wanted a zero. So what do? We created an imaginary number. Right? We just created it. We say, here it is. And it turns out it was a great creation because it allows us to solve lots of problems in the real world. Now I want you to rewrite that as x squared plus x plus 1. So erase the 1 and put an x there and then put a plus 1 afterwards. So x squared plus x plus 1. Right. So I work, very nice. Yeah, see who's got the bigger one here. I work with zeros and ones. Remember, I only work with zeros and ones. That's all I'm allowed to only use zeros and ones. And 1 plus 1 is 0. You got to remember that 1 plus 1 is 0 in the world that I work with. All right. Can you find a solution, either a 0 or a 1, that when you plug into these expressions, I'm going to get 0? What happens when you plug in 0? What do you get? What happens when you plug in 1? But when you take the remainder divided by 2, you get 1. So you get 3, but when you divide by 2, the remainder is 1. So there's nothing in my world that solves these equations. These are unsolvable in my world. Okay, I can't solve them. So what do? I do what we did earlier. I just create a number and I call it alpha or beta, or I choose my favorite letter, R. You know, whatever letter I want, I choose it, and that becomes part of my field. And so that's sort of the world I work with. And I try to do these same matrices here. And then I hope that somehow, I keep praying that one day someone, because I want to keep getting funded, I keep hoping that one day someone can use this. I just do it for fun, remember, but I keep hoping that somebody will find a use for this this work that I like to do. And so I look at the dihedral group, and so this is explaining what I just said. So I look at the same group that you saw earlier, so I'm still rotating, I'm still flipping, but instead of using all the real numbers that I know, I can only use zeros and ones, zeros and ones. And so this is an example of a representation in the world that I work with. And what happens, and again, only the front row is going to be able to see this, but let me take this R and multiply it, put it to the fourth power. So here's the R I'm working with. It's a big one. And when I raise it to the fourth power, and then the people in the front have to confirm it for you. I wish I could zoom in, but I don't know how to do this. But what happens, so let me go to both sides. There's ones along the diagonal, and then on the, and there's zeros in a lot of places, but the other places have fours and tens. The places that don't have zeros has fours and tens. But remember, in the world that I work with, they're zero. Because when you I only look at remainders. I don't look at the number, I look at remainders. And four, when you divide by two, the remainder is zero. And 10, when you divide by two, the remainder is zero. So to me, this is the identity matrix. This is exactly the same matrix I started off with. And same thing with the S. And so what happens when I change my conditions like this, when I only allow myself to work with zero and one, instead of having five building blocks, we actually have an infinite number of building blocks, an infinite number. Like, I can't count them. There's just tons of them. And so this makes my problem a little bit more difficult for classifying and for working. It's not as easy as it was when we're working over the complex numbers or the real numbers. And then I try to tweak it even more. I say, OK, this is good. But instead of working over a field, so a field is the complex numbers, the real numbers. A field, for those of you that don't know, it's a fancy word for saying you can find a multiplicative inverse for every number that you're working with. Okay. So for example, the integers are not a field. The integers are the whole numbers, positive and negative. Because if you look at the number 2, what number can I multiply times 2 to give me 1? The only number that I know that gives me 1 is 1/2. But the problem is 1/2 isn't an integer, isn't a whole number. And so that's why the integers aren't considered a field. They're considered something called a ring. A field are the numbers that you guys have worked with for a long time now. You know, 2 1/2, those are inverses. 3 1/3, those are inverses. And so that's what we're looking for. 0, of course, doesn't have an inverse, but that's OK. 0 is a special number. So here, this symbol, this ring that I work with is sort of very complicated. Now, I'm assuming now the room's going to get smaller. How many of you have had abstract algebra? Anybody? Abstract algebra? OK, so you will know this. Never mind then. But it turns out that this ring is somehow very closely related to the field that I work with. And that's the questions that I'm interested in. How can I relate these two different representations? And this one's kind of easy, it's not too hard to see, but how can I relate these representations? And then the real question is, well, why do we even care? I mean, why would you want to do this? Because eventually people do want to know why this is important. And this is sort of the reason why it's important. I'm only going to go over the first one because of time, but I'm assuming you guys were born around this time? So you guys missed the fact that this is a big deal. Okay, this is a huge deal back in 1995. I can't believe you guys were like born around that time. It's crazy. I was barely in college. you guys recognize this if I put a 2 here. If I put a 2 here, a 2 here, a 2 here for n, what do you call that theorem when it's 2's instead of n's? Pythagoras. And so, do you know any whole number solutions to the Pythagorean theorem? Whole numbers that work in the Pythagorean theorem? 3, 4, 5. What do we call that? Pythagorean triple. And so people say, oh, this is really cool. These are Pythagorean triples, 3, 4, 5. Can anybody name a different one?
5, 12, and 13.
Very good. So 5, 12, and 13. And so then the question was, well, can I do this for numbers that are bigger than 2? And so Fermat said, it wasn't really a theorem, but he said, yeah, this is impossible. It only works for 2 and 1. It doesn't work for anything bigger than 2. He says, and I have a really cool proof of it. And he wrote in his book, I have a really nice proof of it, but unfortunately it doesn't fit in the margin. And then he never wrote the proof. And people found his book and they go, so what do we do with this now? And people have been trying to prove this for 300 years and it didn't get proven correctly until 1995. So we don't think he actually proved it. We actually believe there's just no way he could have proven this theorem. It took 300 years and this is how much information is needed to be able to prove. Look at how simple that is. So this is my end of my journey in numbers. Well, not the end, but the start of something. First, so start of a new journey, but I think this is a very, again, we're talking about numbers here, whole numbers. We're not talking about fractions or decimals. I'm just saying whole numbers A, B, and C, when you raise them to a power, we can't find solutions to this. And this is how much math it takes to understand why that's true. This is a conference. It started on Wednesday at 9 in the morning, and it went, and every day it started at 9 in the morning and went till 4. And it went from Wednesday to Saturday of 1 week, and then Monday to Friday of the other week. These were just talks, people talking about all the math that was required. And then they even had sessions in the end so you can kind of practice the math. It was so difficult. This is how long it took us to prove Fermat's theorem. And there's certain sections here. I know, I don't understand it, most of this, by the way. Wherever I see the name very major, deformations, Galois representations, deformations, Galois representations, that's the stuff that's related to my field. That's what I work with. I call what I just showed you in the earlier slide, this ring, this representation that I have down here, these matrices, that's called the deformation. And that's what I like to study because we don't understand this very well. It's brand new, 1995 for math, that's very brand new. I know it's like 20 years ago, but for us, this is extremely brand new. This is a type of math we don't understand and we're trying to understand it. And it's been very useful. In fact, we were able to use it to prove 2 other theorems that were kind of important in number theory. Again, my new journey is that I hope that one day I can actually understand most of the things that are on this board. Right now, the math is very difficult for me, and I have a PhD. And in fact, most PhDs in mathematics would have a hard time following any of this. It really is very difficult. But this is sort of the stuff that we like to do. And so now I'm restarting a journey. I'm teaching this sort of stuff I find interesting. And now the beginning of the new journey is as a teacher at the college. And I'm trying to instill this idea that it's okay to just like math just because it's math. You don't have to apply it to anything. But if you do apply it, that's great. I'm glad there are people out there that apply it because we need you. We need lots of you. The more people that do math, the better. And that's one of the goals in my career is to try to encourage more people to feel comfortable with math and to see different types of math like this because I think our biggest goal now is to really learn how to code. I think coding is extremely important. And stuff like this really makes coding much easier. And so the deeper you can get into math, and specifically linear algebra. Linear algebra, you really want to understand linear algebra, because that's the only thing we all understand is linear algebra. So please, when you take that class, focus on that one. That one's the most important math class you'll ever take. I think I'm out of time. So I'm going to stop here, but thank you for having me. I can talk forever, I apologize, but do you have any questions or anything that you'd like to?
Not one? Come on. Let's give him a good question.
Too many matrices.
Oh, there's one right there. Let's do it.
Sir, how do you come up with some of the shapes that you study?
Oh, these are classical shapes. I don't study these shapes at all. In fact, I was going to show you a different group later. I was going to show you this one. This is my thesis. This has nothing to do with shapes at all. One day I tried to figure out if this had to do with a square, and it doesn't. But at all. I really tried my best to see if it was possible. But it turns out that this is sort of the first thing we understood a few hundred years ago. And after squares, people do hexagons and pentagons, and they can do this. You can do the same thing with any shape that you want, and sort of describe these types of matrices. In fact, in those of you who've taken linear algebra, there's a matrix I think that is sine theta, negative cosine theta, sine theta. You guys ever remember seeing something like that in linear algebra?
Yeah.
Is that correct? Did I get it right? I always forget. I have to reformulate it. I have to reprove it to myself every single time. But
it's cosine theta, negative sine theta, sine theta, cosine theta.
Right. So that's what this is. Cosine of 90 is 0. Sine of 90 is 1, but then there's a negative, right? Then the sine of 90 is 1 and the cosine of 90 is 0. So that's where this is coming from. So we've been using this, and so when you talk about other shapes like that, that's where it's coming from linear algebra. But yeah, I don't deal with geometry very well. I only do this because I think most people will find this more interesting than what I really don't care about geometry that much. I mean, I do care, I like it, I love proofs, but I don't see my research visually. I see my research like numbers. It really is that. My mind thinks in numbers. Whenever I had geometry, I had to think of numbers first, and then I'd understand. Yeah, geometry.
Any other questions? All right, let's thank Dr. Soto again.